Someplace or and you're worshiping with us, and that gives me joy. Joy just swells up inside me to picture you. I can picture you sitting here, but I picture you sitting in your living rooms. We are so glad you are with us this morning. God bless you.
Thank you, Pastor Dawn. I am Pastor Marcy. I just have a scripture to share with you. This is found in Proverbs 11, verse 25. The generous man will prosper, and he who waters will himself be watered. You know, this is a time where we need to be generous. We need to think about generosity, how we reach out to others, how we share our resources, everything. I want you to know, when we're checking up on people, we can share some of the resources we have here at Cornerstone Church. You can go on our website, www.cornerstonewalker.org/sermons. There are sermon audios from this past year. If you flip to the video tab, there are videos from the past on our YouTube channel. So make use of those. Go ahead and build up yourself, water yourself, and then use those resources to water others as well, encourage others. We may not be meeting together in person, but we can still meet with one another on social media, on the telephone. However we do it, we can still meet together and encourage one another. So you be blessed with that. The other thing we need to do is to share our resources. You know, we do have faithful tithers here at Cornerstone. So go ahead and you can either send your tithe in to www.cornerstonewalker.org/giving, or you can mail your check in to Cornerstone Walker, P.O. Box 1296, Walker, Minnesota 56484. Just so you know, ministries around the world, in our own community even, are suffering at a time like this. Their giving is down. Many of them have fundraising banquets that have been canceled. We give 10% of what we receive out. 50% of that goes internationally, but 50% of that stays right here in our local community to support places that are helping others to know about Christ, to receive food, to receive clothing, to receive counsel. So please be generous in your giving as well. Get online, do whatever, but give, be generous. Now, we have a tremendous message coming today. So you get your Bibles out. After we have the rest of our worship in song, we're gonna have just an incredible message. Get your Bibles out, grab a notebook, grab a pen, jot down what the Holy Spirit says to you, jot down the scriptural references so that you can look them up later and just be encouraged. Let me just pray with you. Lord, we thank you so much for this time of being able to meet together online, and we just pray that you would encourage us, Lord. We bless your name. You are our God. You are our Savior. You are our present help in times of trouble, and you just, Lord, are amazing. And so we praise you, we worship you, and we give you glory in all things. Amen.
This is my prayer in the desert, when all that's within me feels dry. This is my prayer in my hunger and need. My God is the God who provides. This is my prayer in the fire, in weakness or trial or pain. There is a faith group, no more worth than gold. So refine me, Lord, through the flame. I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and he is here. This is my prayer in the battle, where triumph is still on its way. I am a conqueror and co-heir with Christ, so firm on his promise I'll stand. I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall be made. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and he is here. All of my life, in every season, you are still God. I have a reason to worship. All of my life, in every season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. All of my life, in every season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. All of my life, in every season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing. I have a reason to worship. I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and he is here. This is my prayer in the harvest, when favor and providence flow. I know I feel to be emptied again, so what I received I will sow. I will bring praise, I will bring praise, knowing that for the years we shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is here. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song.
Change some things. And as I was worshiping with them when they were singing, it struck me that there's one more song. There's another song, and I know that the Lord's going to bring that song to their heart. and they'll know exactly what it is and just begin to worship with that song. There is one more song, so if you all would just hold your hands out toward them and let the Holy Spirit speak to them, and let's hear what God has to say in worship. When they're ready, they'll let me know. You know, we, none of us have ever been this way before. We are in a desperate time here in our world and in the United States. We are in a time of where many people are moving in fear, many people are sick, many people are wondering what the future is going to bring. Many people are on their knees before the Lord saying, Lord, help us. We need your help. And so we reach out to those people today and we pray for them that the Holy Spirit will speak to them clearly, that those that are sick and suffering physically will be healed just through the words of his song. Through his stripes, we are healed.
Amen.
And so for those people that you know who you are,
yes,
that we are speaking of right now, that have called in, have written in, and said, pray for us, we need healing. Pray for me, we need healing. So Father, I thank you that you will heal these people. You will speak into their spirit. And then meanwhile, Lord, we just continue to move on in you. We don't know where the road will lead us. We don't know what you're trying to tell us, but we have our ear to your heart to understand where we are and how we move forward. You see, we are in this together, and we are better together than separate. So even though we're not here today with one another, we are here in spirit with each person who clicks into this now as well as later today, as well as tomorrow, over the next week. Last week, over 900 people checked this, our website, to hear what God has to say. God bless you. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay. See, I told you God would tell them. So be ready.
word be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you.
Everyone. What a wonderful day this is. I want to talk to you today about the grand design that God planned. I had a whole different message prepared, worked all week on it. And then, as God does often, that just got set aside for some future time because God really spoke to me through a couple of people that made a phone call to my house and asked me one question. How do I follow God? What does that mean? The great question that people ask. How do I follow Jesus? I don't know how. I watch other people and they say they're following Jesus, but I don't know how you do that. And so today, my message comes from Mark 1, verse 14b. So make a note of that, through 18. And after John had been taken into custody, Jesus came in Galilee, preaching the gospel of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." And as he was going along by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net in the sea, and they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men." And they immediately left the nets and followed him. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word today. I pray, Lord, that you have prepared every heart to hear what you want them to hear from your word. I pray, Father, that the anointing of your word pierces hearts and minds and spirits. And so, Lord, today I give you all the glory that each person will hear what you want to say to them. Amen. In Mark chapter 1, verse 15, you don't need to turn there, the distinctive element in his message was about faith and commitment to the Lord, or trust. The necessity of faith is a major subject in Mark, underscoring the theological motivation of why he wrote it to begin with. He was very much concerned about people having faith in God, faith in Jesus Christ, and trusting him no matter what. In the time that we're walking through right now, there are many people that have become ill. Some people have lost some of their relatives or good friends. But we who follow Christ, have the strength of the Lord Jesus Christ within us, and we do not walk in fear. We walk in the trust of the Lord. Jesus showed the way in which all should respond to Jesus, to his summons, promptly, completely. He showed the inseparable relationship of discipleship. In Mark 1:17, the idea is that of responding to a summons, attachment to a person, attachment, acceptance of authority, and imitation of example. The implication of continuation and pursuing a goal also is included. And according to Acts, Christianity later became known as the way to walk, the way in which we live. How do I follow or fellowship with Jesus Christ? Well, first of all, you have to know who you're following. How to follow Jesus. This will be a series as we go along. Christ, the Creator. Let me explain something to you in where we walk today. My husband was a contractor in the cities for many, many years, and I worked in the company also. It was called Lundgren Brothers Construction. It was a business and home building. And so I'm going to use that example. Think of a blueprint, a design, a pattern. What comes to mind if you look at a blueprint laid out on your table? Maybe you're going to build a house and an architect or has drawn the plan for your house and it's laying there on your table. And as you look at that plan, what do you think about? This is what Christ did. What God did, he had a plan for mankind. And so that plan starts out, and we maybe look at that plan laying on our table, but what do you think about? You think, this is going to be my house. I'm going to build this. It's something to work on, something that will take time, energy, skill, resources. Think of the finished product, a commercial building or a home or a barn or some creation, something useful, something beneficial, helpful. Now let's think about Genesis chapter 1. There we see the architect and builder of the universe at work. His design is awesome. His work is nothing short of amazing. And of course, there will be a finished product. Because when he laid out the plan, it had a goal. It had a finishing time. It had a finish to the plan. So it wasn't just the plan laying there. It isn't just the plan laying on the table. That plan is going to be finished, going to be completed. God's work is nothing short of amazing. The creation of the earth and all it contains, the sun, the moon, the stars, all the galaxies, along with countless planets. But with all the many creations of Genesis 1, none of them is the crown of creation. None can be called the most amazing part of his works. You know what the most amazing part of God's work in Genesis 1 was? What would you say it is? Turn to someone and say, I think I know what it is. Well, let me suggest to you, it was the creation of a man and a woman. It was the creation of Adam and Eve. Think about that. None can be called the most amazing of his works except for the creation of man. That's found in the creation of man and woman. They are. We see a most unique part of that blueprint. A purpose fulfilled in Jesus Christ, the last Adam. What is the purpose? What was the purpose of that plan? Consider this. The scriptures reveal that the last Adam was the creator of the first Adam. And you say to me, well, what in the world does that mean? Many people don't bother reading the Old Testament. Many people do read it once or twice, and okay, that's enough of that. But you see, if you don't understand God's creation, don't understand the purpose of why he created it, you can't understand why we're here. What was the purpose of his creating you and I? Why are we even here? What did God intend? Was something wrong? Was something out of place? And if all is not right, then how are things going to be made right? How do we get back on track, back to where God intended us to be, back to God's design, and back to his purpose for us, you and I today? I'm going to try to answer these questions in just the next maybe 3 hours. So if you just hang on and be patient, we'll try to answer some of these questions today. The rest will come in the following Sundays. Our journey will take us back even before the beginning of the time as we know it, into eternity past, before time. We'll enter into the counsels of the Godhead, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the ultimate design for man. We'll see this in more than a generic design. You see, this is personal. This is personal for you and for me, for each one of us. It's personal. Well, what did God design us for? And the only place we can find out what that's for is in Genesis chapter 1 through 3. We're not going to read all those today, so understand that. We must delve into this matter of the first man, Adam. What can we learn about Christ and what it means to follow him? Let's look at the beginning. Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Genesis means beginning. The very beginning is the beginning of anything, everything. God wasted no time trying to prove that creation existed. He just spoke it into being. He simply states a fact.
Yeah.
He does not spend time defending that fact. He just does it. Mm-hmm. He did it. He simply defines that fact so that we can understand who he is. That's why we're here today, to understand who he is. Who is this man, Jesus, that we are to follow? Who we are, and how are we to relate to him? Psalm 33. Verses 6 and 8 through 9. 6, by the word of the Lord, the heavens were made. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made. Verses 8 and 9, let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him, for he spoke and it was done. He commanded and it stood fast. Isaiah 43, verses 10b through 11. Yet for us there is but one God, the Father, from whom are all things, and we exist for him, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we exist through him. Now I know that sounds convoluted, it sounds confusing. It's clear that God declares himself to be the creator of all the heavens and the earth, of all that we can see, and even what we cannot see. He spoke and created. He just spoke it into being. Out of nothing, he made everything. Out of absolutely nothing. You see, you and I, if we're going to create something, we need to get something in order to create it from. Mm-hmm. But God went into the void of nothing and created everything that we see.
Amen.
That's amazing, isn't it? What an awesome God we serve. We need to come into that deep relationship with him in order to know who we are and why we are and what was his purpose for us. He's the ruler of the realm of man. He knows exactly what man needs and provides it throughout the earth. He knows everything that you need. He knows everything about you. He knows what you think. He knows what you do. He knows what you're doing right now. He knows what he has called you to do. And he also knows if you're not doing what he's called you to do. He knows it all. He is wise and wonderful in his creativity. Full of life and power. He's the creator of the clouds and the lightning, the winds and the rain. He is the maker of all, the Bible says, worthy of our worship and our obedience. The Lord made the world and all the things in it, and is clearly declared Lord of all. He needs nothing, since he made it all. That is, and he is the one who ever gives gifts to life and breath in all things. He created man and orchestrates the times of man on the earth. He has control over everything that happens. in the places they live, in the places we travel, in the places that we go. God created marriage and families, foods and feasts, and designed that we gratefully enjoy all these things. All these things have come from Him. All that God created is good, the Bible says, made for the well-being of men and women. Everything that's around us was made for our well-being. Wow, what a God. What an awesome God. For the enhancement of our relationship with God and one another. All we see should lead us to a greater gratitude and worship of our Creator God. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 45 says, "So also it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living soul. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit." The last Adam is Jesus Christ. Amen. This scripture speaks of the last Adam, Jesus Christ. We'll discover much about him as we continue to look in the Sundays coming up. But for today, what part does Jesus Christ play in this matter of creation according to the New Testament scriptures? What holds all these things together? Scientists speak of the atom as the smallest unit of matter. It's made up of neutrons and electrons and protons, all the things I never studied when I was in high school because I didn't want any part of them. It was just kind of boring. I thought, who needs all this? Now I want to know all that. Now I wish I would have studied more. But what holds all that together? What is it that does that? What is the glue that keeps things in place? Scientists are unsure, but from scripture we would say that the glutron is Jesus Christ. He holds all things together. John 1:1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." John declared that the Word is God coming to earth as Jesus Christ. He was in the beginning and the creator of all that is. And apart from him, nothing came into being. From the minuscule molecules to majestic galaxies, he created it all. Paul acknowledges that he is the Lord, and by him are all things. That's our Lord Jesus Christ. Colossians 1:15 through 17, I know I'm throwing out a lot of scriptures, you can look at them later, and I want you to look at them, and I want you to pray over them, and ask, what is God saying to you? Verse 15, "And he, Jesus, is the image of the invisible God that we cannot see, the firstborn of all creation. For by him, Jesus Christ, all things were created, both in the heavens and on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created by him and for him." Mm-hmm. In verse 17, "And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together." Yes. Wow. Jesus is the manifest image of God, the firstborn of all creation. Firstborn doesn't mean that he was born first, but it's rather a title referring to the preeminent one. He is before all things. He is preeminent. He is over all things. Jesus Christ as Lord and Creator, creating all things, in all places, in all dimensions. All was created by him and for him, and he's the one who holds it all together. Through Jesus, the world, or the ages, were created. Those terms referring to all we know of this universe and this time frame. Not only did Jesus Christ create all, Hebrews 1:3 affirms he upholds all things by the word of his power. Now that we see Christ as the creator, we need to look at his creation. Read the account in Genesis 1:31 when you have more time. We're not going to read it all now. God saw all that he had made, and behold, it was very good. When we look around at his creation, even today, we look outside our windows, or we go for a walk in the woods, or we travel and go sightseeing. It is amazing what he created, and everything works together. The more you study it, the more you understand it. We find here a threefold purpose for the creation of man. After God had created all the essentials of the earth, the sky, the water, the land, the plants, the animals, then he created Adam and Eve. The first purpose of the Godhead was the creation of man. In our image, it says, in the image of Jesus Christ, in the image of the Holy Spirit, in the image of God the Father, the image and likeness of God. That included both male and female. He blessed them and commanded them to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. Not only did God want them bearing his image, his first purpose, that's his first purpose, were to bear the image of God. We say, how can I do that? How can I? I'm not God. No, you're not. But you do have Jesus Christ, and it's Christ's image that lives through us. Not only did he want them bearing his image, his first purpose, he also wanted them to be fruitful. What does that mean? Bearing children who would carry that image throughout the earth. That's our second purpose. And in so doing, fulfill the third purpose of reigning over creation. He gave them oversight of the earth to subdue it and rule over all he had created. Doing so with God's character and care. That's revealing love and righteousness and goodness in the image of God. God saw this creation and this design as very good. It had a purpose. This plan that we laid out on our table has a purpose. And it's to build that plan until it is formed completely in all things. With Adam, God took a special hands-on approach, forming him from the dust and then breathing in DNA, the breath of life. Adam was unlike any other creature that had been created. He came alive by the breath of God and bore God's image. He was made for a relationship, person to person, heart to heart, mind to mind, spirit to spirit, a relationship with God himself. And when we look back and study about the Garden of Eden, we find that in that garden, it was a perfect garden. It was perfect. There was nothing wrong in it. Everything was perfect. God created it and saw it and looked at it and said, it is good. Mm-hmm. That's what God created. Mm-hmm. And Adam and Eve lived in that garden, in that perfect garden. The Bible says that they walked with God in the light of the day. They walked with God. They talked with God. He walked with them. They laid eyes on him. He laid eyes on them, and they walked and talked in the garden. That's amazing. That was the relationship they were supposed to have. And that is the relationship that man is supposed to have, to walk and talk with God. You see, God loves us. He created us, and he wants to communicate to us. He wants to talk to us. He wants to lead us. He wants to guide us. He wants to teach us. Relationship with God. God intended for mankind to bear his image and his fruit. In addition, Adam had a specific assignment given him personally by the Lord. First, he was to cultivate or grow, as well as keep and guard the garden in which he lived. With that came the call always to choose good and never the knowledge of good and evil. Here we see the relationship between Adam and God taking shape. The Garden of Eden was a playing field in which they began to fulfill God's call and God's creation. God would make sure it would not be a solo walk, and he created Eve. Genesis 2, verse 18 says, then the Lord God said, it is not good for a man to be alone. I will make him a helper suitable for him. So what does that mean, a helper suitable for him? Well, when you go back into the original scriptures, you find out that a helper suitable for him means someone perfect for Adam, the very perfect mate for him, the one that would be strong when he was weak and be weak when he was strong. The one that would work with him and be with him and love him and care for him. That's a suitable helper. That's what each one of us looked for when we were, well, maybe we didn't when we were looking for a spouse. We didn't think about looking for someone suitable for us. We wanted to find someone who loved us, right? But God loves us. God loves us in powerful ways. Suitable for him means equal to. Not more than, not less than, not stronger than, not weaker than, but equal to the man. Together they could follow God, walking in his will, obeying his word, enjoying the experience of bearing his image and fulfilling his purpose in their lives. How well are you doing at fulfilling God's grand design in your life? Pause and pray and talk to the Lord about his purposes for you. Ask him to make his purpose clear as you walk through his word this week. God set the grand design in motion. God had prepared the garden home. It was perfect. There was nothing wrong in it as the place in which his purposes were to be carried out. Adam and Eve were designed and directed to follow God. Together, they could reflect the image of God, bear the fruit God desired and designed, and reign over creation, growing and guarding it as God directed. Adam and Eve were designed to follow God. Together they could create and reflect the image of God, bear the fruit God desired. But then something happened, which we all know about. Temptation entered the perfect garden. The consequences of sin followed. In Genesis 3, 6 through 12, the great debate. In Genesis 3, 6 through 12, I won't go there now. We will take much too much time, but the great debate about who caused who to fall. We know that Satan, we know that the devil, we know the snake came in, and we know that the heat convinced Eve that she could eat of the apple, it was good, and then she would know so many things. I'm not going to read those scriptures right now. And so she did take a bite of it, and then she offered it to Adam. But Adam chose to take a bite of it. So both of them were rebelled against what God had told them to do. And so they chose to go against what God had told them to do. Sin totally shattered the fellowship Adam and Eve experienced with God. And when that happened, remember, they were naked in the garden. They were in a perfect place. They were totally naked. They weren't concerned about being naked. It didn't bother them one thing, one bit. But they were naked. And then all of a sudden, they heard God's voice calling them. Adam, where are you, Adam? Do you think God didn't know where Adam was? He knew exactly where Adam was, just as he knows exactly where you are, exactly where I am. He knows where we are. But he said, where are you, Adam? Because he wanted Adam to realize that he was out of relationship. He had moved out by choices that he made. And so, what did Adam and Eve do? They tried to hide. And what do we do when we get involved in sin? When we know we have rebelled against the Lord, we have gone not the way the Lord wanted us to go, but we went another way. And we realize that we have walked in sin. And we become ashamed, and we try to hide. We try to stay away from God, stay away from maybe even family. It happens all the time. All you need to do is read Genesis, and you find out what happened. Now Adam and Eve were running away from God. With Adam's disobedient sin entered the human race. Instead of a fullness of life and following and with fellowship with God, they experienced death and separation from God. Eve was deceived when the serpent came tempting her to eat from the forbidden tree that she knew to be off limits. She was deceived and ate and gave it to Adam. Sin shattered the fellowship between Adam and Eve and God. With Adam's disobedience, sin entered into the human race. Instead of the fullness of life, they experienced death and separation. And so what did God do? You know, I will say to you that I don't believe they suddenly looked at themselves and saw that they were naked. Because they'd been naked all along, and it never bothered them. So I don't think they all of a sudden, after they committed the sin of disobedience to God, that they looked to themselves and said, oh, we're naked. No, I believe something else happened. You see, up until they sinned, the glory of God rode on them. The glory of God clothed them. They were supposed to be the glory of God, and it clothed them and covered them. But when they sinned, the glory of God moved away from them. The glory of God lifted off of them, and now there they were, naked. Naked. And they tried to hide. But God found them. And what did God do? Their sin created the first death in the Garden of Eden. In that perfect place, God had to kill an animal, skin that animal, and cover them with the skin of the animal. Genesis 6, verse 5 reveals the condition of man. Instead of reigning over life, man was enslaved to selfish, sinful desires. Man was doing a poor job of cultivating and guarding what he had been given. Instead of nourishing and growing life in goodness and purity, man had corrupted life. The condition of man is hopeless, apart from the work of God on his behalf. We are hopeless without Jesus Christ. We are hopeless without him. We don't always make the right decisions. We don't ask him to guide us. We don't ask him to change us. We don't ask him to come and fill us. John 1:14 says, and the word became flesh, well, and welcoming us, and we beheld his glory. Glory is the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. Jesus, who is God, is known in the Bible as the Word. The Word. A picture of a clear expression and communication of God to man. To make himself clearly understood, he became flesh. He became flesh so that we could understand who God is. That he has a love and a passion for us. And there's no mountain too high or no river too broad that he won't try to step in and save us. That he won't come to our salvation. That he won't come to bring us home to him. Jesus Christ in John 14:6 said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. So in closing, let me say this. God has a plan for my life. God has a plan for your life. God has a plan for each life out there. He's designed you for that plan. You have specific gifts and talents that he has put within you for that plan, for what he wants to do in your life. So what have you done? I'm going to ask you today that this is a time to turn your life over to Jesus Christ. If you once knew Jesus Christ as your Savior, but you turned and walked away, as I did many 30 years ago or more, turned and walked away from the Lord that saved me. What a terrible thing to do. And how I suffered after that, not knowing the disastrous outcome of what would happen if I turned away from the Lord. Another time I'll tell you more about that. But I rededicated myself to God. You see, when we come to him and we repent of the sin of rebellion, the sin of not listening, the sin of turning away from him, the sin of not following him, he wants the highest and the best for each one of us. Amen. He wants us to be successful, yes, in what we do. He wants to fill us with who he is, yes, and with the Holy Spirit. And so he's designed you for his plan, a part of the plan. I'm just going to ask right now that you just close your eyes, bow your head, and listen to me as I pray for you. If you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, if you believe that he was indeed crucified, that he took your sin upon himself, and then God could not look at him. He cannot look at sin. He cannot have any part of sin. And he looked away. And Christ said, why, God, have you deserted me? Why have you left me? But you see, when we repent of that sin, we don't die. We may physically die, we may be buried, but we will rise again with Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Jesus Christ rose again.
Yes, Lord.
And many, he was seen by over 500 people after he rose again. Now he wants to rise again in your life.
Yes.
He wants to come into your life, yes, and create a new being.
Yes, Lord.
And so I ask that you right now say, Lord, here I am. I return to you, Father. Forgive me for the sin in my life. Forgive me for turning away. Forgive me, Father, for all that I have done. But renew me and refresh me. I believe that you are my Savior. I ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. May God richly bless you and touch you and heal you. And I say this in the name of Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you all. God bless you. We'll look to see you next Sunday. God bless.